and Savior Jesus Christ. It is wonderful to be in God's house this morning. I'd like to welcome our visitors who are here with us today. It's an honor that you're worshiping with us, and I pray you would be with us again very soon. Worship service day is Divine Service Setting 3, which begins in the front of your hymnal this morning on page 184. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit,
amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you
forgave the iniquity of my sin. We pause for a moment of silent confession before our God. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you of your boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus, I do forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We sing together today the words of the introit you can find printed on this insert in your bulletin.
Thank you.
statements are in your bulletin. O God, from whom all good proceeds, grant to us, your humble servants, your holy inspiration, that we may set our mind on the things that are right, and by your merciful guiding, accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Sunday of Pentecost is from the prophet Ezekiel, the 33rd chapter. So you, son of man, I have made a watchman for the house of Israel. Whenever you hear a word from my mouth, you shall give them warning from me. If I say to the wicked, O wicked one, you shall surely die, and you do not speak to warn the wicked to turn from his way, that wicked person shall die in his iniquity, but his blood I will require at your hand. But if you warn the wicked man from his way, and he does not turn away from his way, that person shall die in his iniquity, but you will have delivered your soul. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is from St. Paul's letter to the Christians at Rome, the 13th chapter. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority, and do what is good, and you will receive his approval, for he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain, for he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For the same reason, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Owe no one anything except to love each other. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments: you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor, therefore love is the fulfilling of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Thanks
be to God.
We rise to honor our God in the hearing of his gospel.
Calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. But whoever causes one of these little ones who believes in me to sin, it would be better for him to have a great millstone fastened around his neck and to be drowned in the depths of the sea. Woe to the world for temptation to sin, for it is necessary that temptations come, but woe to the one by whom the temptation comes. If your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet to be thrown into the eternal fire. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into the hell of fire. See that you do not despise one of these little ones. For I tell you that in heaven their angels always see the face of my Father who is in heaven. For the Son of Man came to save the lost. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them has gone astray, does he not leave the 99 on the mountain and go in and search for the one that has gone astray? And if he finds it, truly I say to you, he rejoices over it more than the 99 that never went astray. So it is not the will of my Father who is in heaven that one of these little ones should perish. If your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listens to you, you have gained your brother. If he does not listen, take one or two others along with you, that every charge may be established by the evidence of two or three witnesses. But if he refuses to listen to them, then tell it to the church. And if he refuses to listen even to the church, let him be to you as a Gentile and a tax collector. Truly I say to you, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say to you, if two of you agree on earth about anything they ask, it will be done for them by my Father in heaven. For where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am among them. This is the gospel of our Lord. We confess together our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed found on page 191. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven
and sits at the right hand of the Father.
And he will come again in glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Please be seated. We continue with the singing of our next hymn.
Thank you.
grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Text for our message this morning comes from our gospel lesson. Jesus says, whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. These are the words of our Lord that we will meditate upon this morning, my brothers and sisters in Christ. We have a blessing here at Trinity Lutheran Church that we have not had in quite a while. Once again, our pews have young families and children. We as a congregation did not fall into the trap of changing everything that church is to try and get young families to come here. I personally consider that the worst kind of bait and switch there is. The Lord simply kept us faithful in preaching and teaching. You and I of the older generation followed the old God-given proverb, train up a child in the way he should go, but when he is old, he will not depart from it. And now here are our children. With their children. Same church, same Jesus. So as we have been taught by the Lord and blessed by Him with the presence of these young families and their children and their example to us in our church family, let us this morning allow them to teach us. I heard last week that two of our youngest, on their very first day of Sunday school, sat in rapt attention on their little rug, listening to their Jesus story. As they were leaving their classroom, they saw some of the posters up on the wall, and though they can't say a lot of words, said, Jesus. I want you and I to take a little time this morning to remember what that's like. To remember how it is to have such a childlike faith in our Savior Jesus Christ and to desire to just be there, to just be with Him and to listen with rapt attention to the exact same Jesus story. Because when the Holy Spirit brings us to faith through the Word, we spiritually become like little children. In humility. This humility is the exact opposite of human pride, which is the spiritual ruin of mankind. It was the pride of Adam and Eve in the garden, who wanted to be like God instead of being His child. And that caused them to rebel against Him and to bring His curse down upon them and upon the whole earth. And it has been a rebellious and prideful downhill slide ever since. Not so with little children. You see, they have not yet inflated self-estimate of themselves get in the way of their faith toward God. In true faith, in untarnished humility, without any pride, little children accept that they are God's children, and that they have all good things given to them by Him. When little children are told that Jesus loves them, they accept that love with joy and humility. They don't question it. There's no pride in them, like sadly there is in us a lot of times that reject God's simple love. Hey, I'm just too old for that kind of thing. I'm too smart for that kind of Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. You know, the Bible said God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So, children, never give up trusting in God. To our youth, and to we adults, pray God gives to us the humility of children. so that we will not oppose him, and that he may give us grace, the grace we need to save our souls. Another characteristic of little children is their ability to be taught. Young minds soak up everything around them. I have read that in the first 3 years of a child's life, that they are most receptive to learning, and that they integrate almost everything they learn into who they are. That should give us even more reason to follow our Lord's bidding and to teach them to bring even the youngest of our children regularly to God's house, so that the very first thing in their lives that they learn, that they incorporate into themselves in the blessed gospel of Jesus Christ. And for the rest of us, there is no age limit at which we should stop learning. So the question then asks, what is it we should learn? No matter what your age, you can fill your mind either with worldly wisdom, the kind that will draw you away from saving faith, or you can hear the blessed instruction of our Savior Jesus, who said, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and humble of heart, and you will find rest for your soul." We, as adults, have been taught the wonderful saving gospel of Jesus Christ, and we now have the great responsibility, but also the great joy, the great privilege, to pass it on to children, ours and others. You know, during his earthly ministry, people were constantly bringing their children to Jesus because they knew that Jesus was somebody that they needed to be near, somebody they needed to bless their children. And we record in Scripture that one time when people were doing this, that the disciples actually tried to keep these parents from bringing their children to Jesus, and this made Jesus furious at them. How dare anyone, let alone one of my followers, keep anyone, especially these little ones, away from me? Jesus commanded then, and he commands us as disciples today, let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. It is a joy, to lovingly follow this commandment of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring our children to him. You parents, grandparents, others, friends, you brought these children, whatever age they are now, here to God's house. You brought them to the Lord in holy baptism, and now you bring them here to learn about their Savior in Sunday school and here in the divine service. By the way, they will always be here in the divine service. But there is no other place that our children need to be during this hour than here. And I know that you also take them home and you tell them about Jesus throughout the week. And you teachers, you do such an amazing job. And I want to personally thank you for all of your years of service before and now, and maybe in the future, of giving the gift you have of your love for Jesus, of sharing him with these children. By bringing these children and teaching them faithfully every week, rain or shine, they are also learning something else important, is that the Lord's house is where we are to be on Sunday mornings. Never should the question ever be asked in any of our households, are we going to church today? And I want to tell you something else, too. I have the great privilege of being pastor with the longest tenure here at this congregation, and I love my brothers who have come before me. But I think they miss something by having shorter tenures in this congregation, because I have had the joy of watching little children
grow into the mature, spiritual, strong Christian young people that they are today. One day, standing on a pew, saying the Lord's Prayer for the first time, and today to be the amazingly godly men and women that they are. The seed of faith that was planted in them as little children has grown. It has matured, and we should be very thankful to God for the fine Christian people that He has made them. So to you, I say, may God continue to protect you and to help you grow in your faith. A third characteristic of childlike faith that our Lord calls us to is trust. Trust in Him, and that's a hard thing to do a lot of times. I'm reminded of a very true story about a 19th century businessman. He took his young son with him one day to a very important appointment he had first thing in the morning, and he told his son to wait outside the building at the front door until this meeting was over, and he would come back and get him. The meeting went very, very well. The man got wrapped up in his business, and he completely forgot about his son. He ended up going out the back door, went to his office, spent his whole day at work, went home in the evening after a long day and realized his son was not there. And in horror, he remembered what he had done. He raced back into town to the place where his son had been left by him early in the morning. And you know what he found? His son. Sitting right there, waiting for him. I ask you, do we have such trust in our Lord Jesus Christ? I guarantee you He has not forgotten us, but it has been a long time. It has been a long time that we are waiting for Him to come back. Are we trustingly waiting? Or are we going to impatiently go off on our own? Childlike faith. By the grace of God, our children have it. Our youth cling to it. We, as adults, desperately need it, even as the world tries to strip it away from all of us. By the grace of God, it is His gift to us all, this faith in Jesus Christ that saves. Now, we youth and adults, perhaps we need an extra special measure of the Holy Spirit because of how wise we sometimes think we are. In childlike humility, we should all recognize, though, our utter sinfulness and instead look to Jesus Christ alone as our Savior because of His death and resurrection for us. A childlike mind. With a childlike mind, we allow ourselves to be taught by God. We do not judge His word, as so many people want to do today. We do not judge His word. Instead, we let ourselves, our hearts, and our minds, and our consciences be judged by the word. We are the ones who are changed by the renewing of our minds by God's word. We will reject all of our own thinking when it is contrary to the word of God. Because I tell you, there can be no true reverence, no true childlike faith toward God, unless we have this attitude of Scripture, that Scripture rules us. We never rule Scripture. And with childlike faith, we trust Jesus. We trust Him completely, regardless of what this world tries to do to lure us away from Him. We can trust Him because He earned that trust at Calvary. He ensured that trust on Easter morning. He holds us in that trust as He lovingly guides us in word and in sacrament every day and right on into eternity. That day so long ago, the disciples asked Jesus, "Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And Jesus answered them, in effect, "Those who received me in childlike faith and humility." Because you see, in the kingdom of heaven, there is only one great. There is only one source of greatness, and that is the King himself, Jesus Christ. We become great in the kingdom, not by growing up and growing away from the King, but by receiving the great King Jesus and growing closer to him by the humble means of word and sacrament that give us childlike faith. A childlike faith that God calls upon to mature, but to never walk away from its source, Jesus Christ. Like the children long ago, Jesus has laid his hand of blessing upon us in holy baptism. He has taken us up in his nail-scarred arms, and he cares for us every single day on our journey toward eternity. So I remind all of us today, if we have grown too old, too wise, in the things that are drawing us away from God, then put them away. Climb back up on Jesus' lap and become like one of these little ones again. In faith. Childlike, trusting, humble faith. And may Jesus say to anything that would try and keep us away from him, "Let my little children come to me. Do not hinder them. For the kingdom of God belongs to such as these." Please pray with me. Dear Jesus, make me your little child, humble, willing to learn and trusting, and by your cross, keep me a child in your kingdom forever and ever. Amen. Please join. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus unto life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, we'll gather our offerings to the Lord, and I ask that you register your attendance in God's house this morning by signing your name on the pad at the end of your pew. As there were no special prayer requests on the list of this morning, let us rise and lift our prayers and praises to God our Father. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Lord God, Heavenly Father, you have sent us pastors as watchmen, including our pastors and missionaries, John Jenkins, Carl Beckwith, and Fred Reinhardt. Let them be ever faithfully calling sinners to repentance and joyfully announcing your forgiveness to those who heed their warning. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Father, protect and direct all missionaries, especially the Federowitz family, that they would be faithful in their sharing of the true gospel to the world, that those who are lost in the darkness of sin and false hope may come to the assurance of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you are the ultimate authority. Thank you for good government and those who with authority over us. Guide them in using their authority according to your will, and help us to be obedient. Be with those who are under corrupt authority, and give them all boldness and confidence to live in accordance with your will. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty God, you open your hand and satisfy the desires of all living things. Look with favor upon those who farm. Let their harvest be fruitful, that in providing for the needs of their neighbors, they may find fulfillment in their livelihood. We pray also for all the citizens of our nation who are suffering under many natural disasters, that you would watch over them and keep them according to your goodwill. And we pray for all people around the world, especially our brothers and sisters in faith who face persecution for your name. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, let us receive your good gift of Christ's body and blood with childlike faith. Let us humbly trust that your forgiveness is poured out for us in this meal. Let it strengthen us in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Lord, in your mercy. Merciful Lord, look with compassion upon those who are struggling with illness, grief, loneliness, and mental or spiritual malady, especially for Pam and Kay, Willard and Linda, Cindy, Terry, Ellen, and Dorothy, and those we now lift up before you in our hearts. Reassure them of your love, which is like that of a shepherd who seeks and saves the one lost sheep. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue now with the service of the sacrament, beginning on page 194. The Lord be with you. Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us with the same, in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord be with you. Blessed be the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Let us go forth in the peace and joy of our Lord in childlike faith as we sing our final hymn for the morning.